Tuple, you have the first problem. Please be ready with your VS Code. Here comes. Write a Python program to create a tuple with different data types. Instead of apple, I'll just go ahead and put 3. Right? So this tuple. Let me execute this. There you go. You have a tuple which contains different elements of different data type. Perfect, Sandhya. Your answer is correct. Moving ahead. Write a Python program to unpack a tuple in several variables. Var 1 is equals to this tuple of 0, right? Var 2 is equals to this tuple of 1. So when you print var 1 and var 2, I'll get the first and the second elements. The apple and the banana. That's what I meant, right? As simple as that. Yeah. What I'm trying to demonstrate in this program, I'm trying to demonstrate that it can be accessed through the way which we use to access the elements of the link lists, right? As simple as that. Next program. Write a Python program to convert a tuple to a string. I want all the elements in the tuple to be converted into a single string, right? How do you do that? String is equals to empty. I'm going to initialize it. And for I in this tuple, I'm going to say string plus, I mean concatenating I. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to print string. How many of you people think this is correct? What do you think is the output? What do you think is the output, people? Join X. I'm not so sure about it. Let's see, Sandhya. Let's see. How many people of you think this solution is correct? Any of you people find it wrong, find anything wrong? Sandhya says it is going to reverse, print the reverse of the tuple. Okay, fine. Anybody else? Yogesh is right. We have a non-string element here in the tuple. You can't concatenate anything other than string. So in order to do that, you need to convert that particular string, non-string to string. If there is something which is already string and you are trying to convert it, there won't be error. So that's not the issue. So when you execute this, you'll perfectly have the output, right? So let me tell you what happens if I don't convert the variable into string. I'll have the error. You say it cannot be concatenated. Here you go. You have a perfect solution. Okay. Let's see Sandhya's solution. I'm skeptical about this solution. Let's see. So, oh, nice. Okay, this also works. If you want space to be added between the elements, you can use the delimiter space. If not, you can just mention this, right? When you execute this, you have ABCD. Perfect. Shout out to Sandhya. Perfect. Okay, next. Write a Python program to get fourth element and the fourth element from the last tuple. From last of a tuple. Okay, you take up this. Okay, perfect. I want you to print fourth element from the first beginning and the fourth element from last of the beginning. And the solution should be generalized, not only specific to this particular example. Kotraj has given a correct answer. That's right. Join is a method. Join is a method, Yogesh, because anything which should be called using a dot operator is a method. Anything which doesn't need dot operator is your function. Okay. When you use dot operator, when you have a variable, actually it is not a variable, it's an object. Okay. Let me not go. It comes in object orientation. That is out of the scope of this course. So just remember that when you use a variable name and followed by dot, that is your method. When you don't use it, when you push all the things as an argument to something, that will be your function. Sandhya has given the solution. Perfect. Sandhya's solution is great. You can access the fourth element from the beginning using x of 3 and fourth element from the last using x of minus 4. Perfect. Next in the list, we have add an element to the list inside the tuple. Here you have a list. Okay. This is your tuple inside which you have list. Let me print that out for you. Okay, this is the list inside the tuple. How do you add the values into this particular list? Okay, let the solution be the example specific. I don't want you to be general. I know you can't be general with this particular problem statement. I want you to add an element inside this list and give add 5 in middle of 3 and 4. Okay, I want the list to contain 3 comma 5 comma 4, and the tuple should print the updated tuple. In competitive programming, which is the actual door to most of the MNCs like Google, Amazon, Flipkart, in such hackathons, you need to think super fast. Okay, next we have Soundarya solution. She has got this tuple, then she is going to check whether then she is going to iterate through the values of the tuple. Then if she is going to check if that particular element is a list or not, is of type list or not, then she is going to IE dot append. I asked you to place 5 between 3 and 4. Let's see what solution has she got to share it with us. When we execute this, we have perfect. We have got the solution. I want it to be 3, 5, 4. Okay, Soundarya has got the solution. Insert 1, 5. Perfect, Soundarya. The answer is correct. She has iterated through the list, iterated through the tuple, then find out each and every element if it is list or not. Then once it is found list, she is going to insert 5 to that particular list at position 1, and she is going to print the rest of it. So if there is another list inside the tuple, it is going to edit that as well. So as I had told, this the solution should be the example specific. It's okay, this thing works. If there are multiple lists in the tuple, it is not going to work, right? It is going to append, it is going to put all the values inside all the element, all the lists, right? So I appreciate something. I appreciate. Moving ahead, we have write a Python program to find the repeated items of a tuple. Okay, we have the solution. Soundarya has got, count. All right. Soundarya has got the perfect solution. Yes. For I in X, she is going to take a tuple, then she is going to iterate the tuple. Then she is going to take an empty list, then she is going to iterate through the tuple one by one, and she is going to check if that, then she is going to check whether that particular element has multiple occurrences. Like we had seen a method count in the previous slide, right? Which returns the actual count of occurrences of that particular element. If it is greater than one, and she is going to see whether that particular element is not in Y. Y is your output list. She is going to append it to Y. Beautiful solution. I was thinking while and shit. Beautiful solution. Then Yogesh has given a solution. He has taken the tuple. Then he has taken a string for which I don't understand why. He has iterated through the tuple. Then he has, okay, you are searching for a particular string. Understand the question, Yogesh? Yeah. Yogesh, you have drifted off the topic. Yogesh has drifted off the topic. Let's see, Amit. Amit requires time. By the time Amit solves this question, I request the people who had already solved and unable to put it in chat box, or who have actually solved and put it in the chat box, please try the next question. That is, write a Python program to count the elements in the list until an element is a tuple. So our main objective is a list here. So the list contains a tuple at one or the other index. So until and unless that tuple comes up, I want you to count all the elements before the tuple which are not tuple. I want you to return that particular value, the count of non-tuple elements before a tuple is encountered, right? So go ahead. Amit has the solution. If x has a tuple, x is a tuple, then he has taken an empty string. Then what has he done? Okay, he has converted. Okay, what if the element is string? What if the element is list? You can't convert the list into string. And why are you using return keyword? I'm afraid. I don't think so. Your solution is Right, Amit. Soundarya has got the solution for the last question as well. What's correct with this girl? Okay, just not to print again. Return. Return. Why is return used, Amit? Why do you think return is used? Just check on your solution. Just try to execute it. If you have a laptop, just check on your solution once again. Why do you think return is used? And moreover, even if return seems to work there, which actually should be break, if your intention is to quit the for loop, it should be break. Return, I really don't think so. Return will come out of the main function if I'm not wrong. Okay, let's see Soundarya's solution. Soundarya has this solution. She has an X list. Then she is having an integer initialized to zero. Then a variable initialized to zero. Then she is iterating through the list one by one. And inside the list, she has a if condition. Inside if condition, she is checking if the current element in the list is a tuple or not. If it is tuple, she is going to come out of the loop. If it is not tuple, she is going to increment the count variable. Then she is going to print the value of count. Now, tell me that is not beautiful. Amazing. Amazing. Nice. Okay, break. I don't think so. Your solution works, Amit. I really don't think so. Next. Kotresh has this beautiful solution. Let's have a look at it. He has a list named uppercase I. Always I told you should never use uppercase. That is an uppercase I or lowercase l. I'll consider it as a lowercase l, which it is. Then he is going to call the function count of l. Beautiful. I really appreciate that you have used modular programming, which is he has divided the program into functions and he has executed. I really applaud you, Kotresh. He has got, and one more thing, you have violated one more rule. The function should not have an uppercase letter, right? You have used count. C is uppercase. Try to avoid it. I don't say that it is not going to work, but I just say it is not in the convention, right? Make use of lowercase letters. Then you have count. He has captured the list as a parameter. Then he has taken a is equal to 0. Again, what is a? You don't know what is a. You should put it as a count or c or c and t or whatever it is. A is totally out of abstract. What do you mean by a? Right? Readability, Kotresh. Readability. Your program's logic might be correct, but readability also matters. Anybody can write a logic. Anybody with A is a counter, but name it as a counter, na? Okay, you wanted to drift it to counter. Okay, beautiful. See, there is a saying in programming area specifically. Anybody can count, actually. Anybody can write a program. Anybody who knows the language and knows the logic can write a program. Anybody can write a program which machine understands. But only the passionate ones, only the talented ones can write a program which actually a human understands, which human can read. Right, so make sure that you are that talented person. I'm damn sure you have that capability. I'm damn sure that you have that capacity and potential. Make the best use of it. Patresh, note to you. Right, then he has got he has approached the program or the problem in the same way which Soundarya has approached. Beautiful. So I wish I could have taken much more programs, but we are running out of time. Let's move ahead and go to strings. Beautiful topic, strings. Strings has a wide application across your Python applications. You can't separate yourself from strings. We have, in fact, we have been using strings since the very first day. Hello world. We have printed the application which prints hello world. Hello world itself is a string, right? So strings are anything which are enclosed with single inverted commas. Strings are anything which are enclosed with double inverted commas. Strings are anything which are enclosed with triple inverted commas. All right, so what do we have here? Just for your note, I'm going to read out the definition. Like many other popular programming languages, strings in Python are arrays of bytes representing Unicode characters. Again, you don't need to understand what is Unicode. Unicode, let me tell you for your information. Unicode is a way of representing the characters, right? In your machine, just for your information, I'm going to give you, I'm going to tell you. See, your machine doesn't understand what is A, what is B, what is C, what is D, what is capital D, what is capital Z. It doesn't understand any of it. So the point is, how is it going to store the contents of English alphabets? There is a way called encoding. Encoding is containing various standards. You have Unicode standard, you have ASCII standard, you have ASCII is actually predominantly used. ASCII comes under Unicode, right? So you have Latin, codes in which your content is stored. So all these things are there. So Unicode is a way of storing your contents, your alphabets. So these Unicode characters, they are going to get converted into numbers. Those numbers are again going to get converted into binary, which actually the machine understands, right? This is the transformation which happens. So consider if your machine is running on ASCII notations, your if I'm not wrong, your the uppercase A is denoted as 63 or 65. Pardon me if I'm wrong. In ASCII notation, the capital uppercase A is depicted in 63 or 65, and this 65 is actually stored in memory. Right, when it is actually executing in the processor, this particular 65 is going to get converted into binary, which is going to be understood by the machine. So that's exactly how it works. So strings are nothing but the collection of such Unicode characters, right? So when it is actually printing on your monitor, it is again getting converted back to strings, right? First back to Unicode characters, then back to strings, and it is going to get displayed onto your monitor. That is your first thing. Second thing being, however, that just now I explained a deep explanation of how exactly strings are handled in the machine, right? Just for your information. Next being, however, Python does not have a character data type, which is true. A single character is simply a string with a length of one. So we don't have characters, character data type like C, right? Or Java, we have only strings. So anything, if you want to, take a character, you can just mention that particular character in middle of double inverted comma or single inverted comma. And that is actually treated as string itself, and the length will be one. As simple as that. So square brackets can also be used to access elements of the string. So basically, strings are also treated as an array or a list. Right, so explicitly, if you want to get it as a list, you can use a list constructor. Okay, let me demonstrate that for you. So here in the example, while the IDLE opens, let's see the example. Example says A is equals to hello, and you are going to print A, right? A is equals to hello, and you are going to print A, right? Which is hello, right? So you are you can, if you want a discrete list, you can mention this A is equals to list of A, right? When you print A, it will be list of characters or strings. There are no characters in Python. We have strings. So it is a list, a series of list of strings of length one. You have H E L L O, right? That is your list. Although you can, you can access it as a list without, converting it into list, like A of 0. What do you think is the output? Anybody? A of 0? Make it fast. Patrish, Amit, Chaitra. I can see Chaitra. Okay. Manishri, perfect. H, perfect. Your answer is correct. The answer is H. If I want A of 1, what do you think is the output? Manaswini, come on. What do you think is the output? A of 1. Perfect. E. No. Only Kavita has given the correct answer and Karthik has given the correct answer. Right? Karthik has complete correct answer, which is E enclosed with single inverted commas. Right? Chiran says 0. For what reason? I don't know. Maybe typing mistake. All right, no problem. Next, we have, yeah, that's it. Next, multi-line strings. If you want multi-line strings, if you want to include the next line character, you can use triple inverted commas. Triple inverted commas can be constituted with double inverted commas or single inverted commas. Let me tell you what I mean. Here you can see triple inverted commas of double inverted commas. Understand what I'm trying to say. Here, as you can see, this is triple inverted commas, which individually are double inverted commas. Right? Are you following me? Yes? Are we on the same page? Yep. This can also be put into notation, like instead of double inverted commas, you can also put single inverted commas. Right? Both mean the same. Okay, Aditya asks, inbuilt function to get Unicode of a string. Probably there is a function called ASCII. ASCII, A-S-C-I-I. I need to check on it. Right? Let's see the methods. Let's see the methods later. Now tell me, where did we use triple inverted commas earlier? Can anybody tell me where did we use triple inverted commas earlier? Comments. Can anybody be much more specific? Multi-line comments. We have, hope that is clear. Next, we have strings or arrays. As I told you before, strings are arrays and the starting position is 0 and the end position is length of the string minus 1. Next, string slicing. You can also do string slicing just like you did in list and tuple. Can anybody tell me what is the output of this? Let me change this to 5 to 8. Can anybody tell me what is the output? LLO, comma, space, W. Perfect quadration. Now second index 0, 1, 2, 3, yellow, comma, space, one second, I lost it. 0, 1, 2, 3, starting from LLO, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So it will end at W, right? LLO, comma, space, W, capital W, perfect. Perfect. Right, Sojal, why do you think so? End minus 1. Always remember, end minus 1. Don't forget. Okay, next. Negative indexing. If you have doubts, Sojal, please type it up. Type it down. Okay. Negative indexing works same way as it worked in list and tuple. I think you people might be masters in this. In negative indexing by now. Yes? Can anybody tell me what is the output? Yes, make it fast. If you people think it is fast, please tell me. ORL. Sundara says ORL. Shweta says WOR. Okay. Let's check. Minus 2. So it starts from minus 1, minus 2. It starts from D. Minus 2, minus 3, minus 4. Okay. It doesn't start from D. It starts from L. Okay. Sorry. It ends at L. Okay. You know why. I don't need to explain you people. L minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 3, it will be ORL. ORL, am I right or not? Minus 1, minus 2, gone. Minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, ORL, perfect. It will be ORL. Let's check. Tell me, what is it? Minus 5 and minus 2, right? ORL, yes. Next, string length. Oh, same. Easy to remember. Python is amazing. Ain't it? Len. You use len function? No. Yeah, it is a function. Yes, it is a function. You use len function and there you go. You have the length of the list. Sorry, length of the string. You have checking strings. Beautiful, beautiful. You have checking strings in which you are going to see to check if a certain phrase or character is present in a string, we can use keywords in or not in, right? If you, in C, you need to take, what is that? Import string, and one more thing, what is that? STR, what is it? Substring. I forgot, man. No, there is no such function called substring. There is something called str, correct? Str inside that you need to send your string as a parameter, and the second parameter should be a second argument should be your substring, which you want to check. It is going to return binary values, true if that is a substring, if not, it's not. But no such headache in Python. You just need to use in operator. You take a string variable, then you are going to check if that particular substring which you want to check space in space that particular string, parent string, it is going to return your boolean value true if that is a substring, false if it is not. So what do you think, this will return true or false quickly? String.h, Manaswini is right. String.h. So Sandhya says it is true. Let's see who can defeat Soundarya. Right? She has been answering since ever. Let's see who can defeat Soundarya in her solutions. Next being true. Right? Then you have Aditya. We are running out of time. Just save that particular doubt. Let's have a doubt session later. All right? Next you have check if the phrase AIN is not present in the following text. You just use not behind in, and there you go, your solution is ready. If AIN not in TXT, you'll have a binary value. Either it is false, either it is true. So be careful with it. It is like there is a saying in English. The black people in the West Coast say it. West Coast of USA. What is that? Ain't nobody likes me, which means I don't like nobody. Correct. I don't like nobody. What actually they mean is they are not going to like anybody. But if you go on literal meaning, they are actually saying that they are not liking anyone, which actually means they are liking everyone. So something like that. Thinking programmatically, of course. So all of you, as you know, negative of negative is always positive. So if you check if this particular thing, this is positive and this is negative, that is AIN is actually the substring of TXT, and you are going to check it is not in text, so you are going to get negative, that is false, right? So hope this makes sense. I don't know if it makes sense for you or not. I just told what was inside my brain, right? Next, string concatenation. You just use your plus operator, and there you go. You have added two strings. A is equals to hello, B is equals to world. If you add those two variables, you'll get the third variable, which is C, which is actually the concatenation of the strings A and B, and you're going to print it, right? Then you have, if you want to, that can be done on n number of strings. Theoretically, there is no limit on the concatenation operators. You can go on adding infinite number of theoretically, although there are constraints like your screen buffer constraints, right? There are constraints like your human constraints. You can't go on typing infinite number of times, right? All those things. Vastav, I request you to turn off your camera. Accidentally, it has been turned on, just in case if you don't know. All right. Thank you, Vastav. Vastav has left the meeting. All right. Hopefully, he comes back. Next, if you want to add a string literal, right? If you want to add the constant itself without using any variable, you can also do that, right? In this case, they have added a space, a small space in middle, right? This will print. What is the difference between print? See this, what will be the difference in the output with this particular print statement and this particular print statement? Can anybody tell me? Yes. Space. Perfect. Right. In the first print statement, you are not going to get any space between hello and world. In the second output, you are going to get a small space, a single space between hello and world. Perfect. Moving ahead, string formatting, right? Same way, same concatenation, but you are using the constant. Now comes the big question. What is the output of print text? Yogesh says error. Anybody else? My name is Kotrai says my name is John and I am 36. Karthik says my name is John and you are 36. I am 36. Aditya says error. Shweta says my name is John and I am 36. Saraswati says my name is John and I am 36. Arshad says my name is John and I am 36. Manaswini says error. All of you, I mean, most of you people have, you know, snorted shoe polish or something. I don't know. Previous, a couple of slides ago, only in this presentation, only we have seen it is going to throw an error until and unless the concatenation is done between strings. What is the data type of 36? Is it a string or or an integer? It is a integer. So when you are going to try to concatenate with a string, you are going to get an error, right? So this is an error. What do you have to, what should you modify? Give me two ways of modification to not get an error and get an output. My name is John and I am 36. That is one solution. STR of age. Soundarya says use format. Okay, advanced. Okay, plus STR of age. Any other solution? Any other solution? Perfect. Chiran gives a wonderful solution. You actually convert the variable age into string itself, right? There are three ways of doing it. Yes, perfect, Yogesh. That's the correct answer. Next, you can do this or you can use string formatting as suggested by Soundarya, right? What do you do in string formatting? Just like we did it in string formatting in print function, you can do this as well. You can mention that particular template of the string. This is the template. So whenever you want to fill any new data at that particular place, you are going to take that particular template and use format. Use format, right? So what does this particular thing do? It is going to take the content of the variable age and it is going to put it in the place of this curly braces, right? As simple as that. Next, you can do that. Okay, again, theoretically, there is no limit. Theoretically, there is no limit on number of curly braces to be used. However, there is a limit on your constraints, like physical constraints, like your hardware, so on and so forth. Theoretically, you can mention infinite number of curly braces and infinite number of, you know, constants or the variables to be mentioned inside. Hope this is clear. Anybody has any doubt? Do you want me to, explain this once again? Anybody? Okay, Vinay. Here is the repetition. See, you have a string, right? That string is actually a template, okay? That string contains a part where actually it is variable. It might be 39 this year or it might become 39 day after tomorrow, right? This is a variable place and you want to keep it dynamic, right? You don't want this to be constant. So in that case, what you do, you mention a pair of curly braces inside that particular string. Then whenever you want to access that particular string, you are going to take that particular string name and put dot operator in front of it. After dot operator, you put format method in front of it. Then pair of parentheses inside which you just mention the variable whose value should be added in the place of the curly braces. As simple as that. Nothing else, right? So what is this going to print? Can anybody tell me what is the output of this particular this one? Yeah, Abhishek is right. Only when I take out this curly braces, right? Yes. Can anybody tell me what is the output of this particular print statement? Okay, Manaswini, Chiran, right. Dhanendra is right. Karthik is right. Purva is right. Saraswati is right. Sandhya is right. Shweta is right. Okay, next we have similar way. I'm going to mention wherever there is a variable to be mentioned, I'm going to mention pair of curly braces and I'm going to use that particular name of that particular variable here, and I'm going to use dot operator, then I'm going to use format method, then I'm going to mention all the variable names whose value I need to replace in those particular places of curly braces. Hope this is clear. Perfect. Next, string formatting. Here you have one more extension of string formatting where what actually is happening is you have you want to index, right? consider this as a list. Okay, consider this particular argument inside the format function as a list. All right, this is the position of quantity is 0, the position of IT EMNO is 1, the position of price is 2. Right, so this much we know. Now you can also mention the index name where the value should go and sit. Consider the arguments as a list. List has index numbers, right? Indices. This quantity is the zeroth index. ITEMNO, that is item number, is your, okay, that sounds so wrong. When I say item number, I mean the variable, right? Don't take me wrong. Item number, okay. Here you have, okay. Now we are going to take the contents of these variables and you are going to place it according to their index number. Here, this particular place says it wants the value of the variable at the zeroth index. So the zeroth index is quantity, the value is 3. So the value 3 is going to be placed here, right? So on and so forth. Can anybody tell me what is the output of this particular function? Arthik is right. Soundarya says, I want to pay $49.95. Let me see. Quantity, what is second index? Second index is your price. What is price? $49.95. Okay, I want to pay $49.95 for zeroth index. What is zeroth index? Quantity. Quantity is 3. Okay. For 3 pieces of item number 5, 6, 7. Okay, let me see. I want to pay $49.96 for 3 pieces of item. For item $567. What do you mean, Zandaria? Your solution is wrong. Okay, second solution. You have second solution correct. Then Shweta's solution is also correct. Dharnendra's solution is perfect. Karthik's solution is exquisite. Kotresh has got a beautiful solution. Yes, all of you people are right. Next. Hope this is clear. Anybody? I understand this is little bit complicated. If anybody didn't understand, please feel free to text it in your chat box. I'm happy to repeat it. Anybody? Okay. Assuming that you people have got it. Moving ahead, before escape sequence, I want you to type this. I want you to print this. Let's take all these things. I want you to print. I want you to print this. If you know how it works, if you know the concept of escape sequence, if you know what to do, then please don't put the solutions. I repeat, please don't put the solutions. So for the people who are totally new to this, they don't know how to do it, please try. How do you print a string inside a string? Some of you might be thinking, what sort of sorcery is this, right? That's a popular meme, just in case if you don't know, right? How do you print string inside a string? At least try, people. Try, come on. Let me see who is there in the chat box. There are 52 people. We have Kavita, we have Aditya, we have Aishwarya Chaugla, we have Aishwarya Ingle, then we have got Aishwarya Benny, then you have got Amit, then Ankita, Anjali. Anjali, I have never seen you trying that. I want you to try. Anjali. Then we have Ankita, Archana. Archana, please try. Arshad, try. Bhagya, try. Chaitra, try. Chetana, try. Chidambar, try. Chetana, I remember you sending money. Please try. Why? What for have you paid? Please try. Deepa, try. Whom do we have? Harshita, please try. Karthik, try. Kavya, please. Manaswini, we have two Manaswinis. I wonder who. The original Manaswini, just make note that there are two Manaswinis. A copy of you, a replica of you, with same Gmail account, with same password, with same DP. If I'm not wrong, you have logged in through two devices, one being your mobile and another being your laptop. Just to make sure that you're online, I mean, in line with what is happening, right? Hopefully that is true. Okay. Saraswati, Sampada, what do we have? Manaswini? Yes. Tejas says this. Tejas, here is what I want. I want you to print exact this. Okay, I want this on the output screen. Aditya, I asked you to shut up, na? Eh? When you print this, you are going to get this error. You should have used plus just in case if you were thinking to do that. Okay, you people are right. Let's move ahead and see this beautiful concept called escape sequence, right? So for computer, certain things are, predefined, right? When you say double inverted commas, it is expecting a string inside it, right? When you say something is fixed and you can't use it, that forms the boundary of the language, don't you feel so? Are you on the same page what I'm trying to say? You are said that, okay, this is the language and this contains this particular set of rules and this is this particular set of predefined values and these values are having this particular meaning and you can't change it. So when somebody says this to you, that forms the boundary. Like you can't go there, right? But when you want to utilize that, when you want to, make use of it, you can use something called escape sequence. How do you do that? You have text as your variable. Then you want to print hello world, welcome. Right? So when you want to print this, it's what is compiler interpreter going to think? String is anything which is enclosed between a pair of inverted commas. So the inverted comma is going to start from this point and it is going to end at this point, and this will be our string. That is what your interpreter is going to think. Right? Now, after that, if you are going to mention anything, that will be considered as your variable. Right? After that, you are going to consider. After that, you are going to enclose a pair of inverted commas, which will be considered as an empty string, right? And it is going to throw an error because this variable is being placed right next to the existing statement, which makes no sense, right? What we are seeing from our eyes is we have a whole string, universal string, which is hello world, inside which we have one more string called welcome. That's how we are seeing. But how is computer seeing? It is going to see that hello world is a single string with a small space at the end, and it is having one more redundant, I mean nonsense, variable name, unidentified variable name, or identifier. It is actually called identifier, right? For the people who know compilers and design, compiler design, they might have learned what is identifier. Right, let me not go there. It is just going to see as one more identifier placed in a wrong place, right? And again, it is followed by a pair of parentheses, which marks the empty string. So that is how the interpreter is going to think. So in order to tell that interpreter is wrong, you have to use something called escape sequence, which means which is going to escape the actual meaning of the existing meaning, right? So escape sequence in Python as well as in C is your backward slash, right? When you use backward slash, the actual meaning of this particular thing will be skipped, right? So now it is like just a string, right? When you use backward slash here, you have your perfect string. When you try to print this, you'll have hello world. Printed hello world space inverted comma open welcome inverted comma close. How beautiful is that? Come and tell me. There is no literally no limit to automata in Python. Can you see that? Can you see the difference? Yes, perfect. Now, here is what I want you to print. Let me see. Let me see the table itself. Okay, here is a table. Now, if you want to print single quote, you need to enclose, you need to precede that single quote with backward slash. If you want to print backward slash itself, you would want to place the backward slash in front of another backward slash. So it is going to escape the meaning of the escape meaning itself. All right. Now, if you want to print a new line, normally n means a character n, right? If you want to print a new line, if you want that particular line to go to next line, you'll use backward slash n. As simple as that. If you want hello world, right, and welcome printed in next line, you'll do this backward slash n and welcome. Let me go ahead and save it. And when I execute this, you'll have hello world in the first line, welcome in the second line. Beautiful. If you want to print backward slash behind welcome, you do this, save it, and when I execute this, you will have hello world and backward slash welcome. As simple as that. Next, you have carriage return. Let's not go towards carriage return, right? Carriage return is something which we use in headers, HTML headers in networking. Just know that backward slash r is carriage return. Never in my entire programming life I have used to carriage return during my program, right? Okay, tab. If you want to leave four spaces, continuous spaces, you don't have to type spaces four times. All right, you can just use backward slash t. Let me demonstrate that as well. When you execute this, you have hello world followed by four spaces, then welcome. Beautiful. Right? If you want to use backspace, you can also use backspace. You can print a word and again delete it. Delete the last particular character. Let's see how it works. I also have never used this. So it is going to delete the last character behind backward slash b. Right? If you want to depict an octal value, you can use backward slash triple o. Lowercase. If you want to depict an hexadecimal value, you can use backward slash xxxhh. Right? So just remember these. You might want to remember the first three and this backspace and the last two. These are the very, very important things which you might want to remember. Carriage return and form feed might not be as useful as we are not going to use it pretty much, right? Moving ahead, we'll go to string methods. These are some string methods which you would want to know that they exist, right? You have capitalize. It will just convert your first character into from lowercase to uppercase, and it remains in the uppercase if it is already in uppercase. Then case fold. What does it do? It converts the string to lowercase. You can have case fold useful. You can have capitalize useful. You can use count. What does count do? Your count returns the number of items a specified value occurs in a string, right? You can take a character or a substring, then it is going to return how many times the substring has occurred in that particular string. It might be very, very useful for your competitive programming. Just make sure that you take down this particular method. Then you have encode. Aditya was asking whether we have an inbuilt method to find the encoded version of a string. Yes, we do. We have encode method. You make use of it. So on and so forth. We have ends with. We are going to check whether the given string is going to end with that with a specified substring, right? Then we have expand tabs. When we use backward slash t. Then by default it is going to be set for 4, right? We can also alter that particular value to 5 or 8 or whichever the value you would love to have, right? Expand tabs. Then you have find. Then you have format, which we have seen. Then we have index, isAlNum. Then you can use isAlpha. You can check whether the given number is purely containing the string or it also contains some things. You can also check if the string is alphanumeric, that is, if the string contains both alphabets as well as numbers. You can also do that. This is predominantly used in web application because it is used in login forms, right, to check your strings of passwords, right? When you enter a password, The application is going to check whether it contains all the strings, or it is going to contain any special characters, or is it going to contain any numbers. So in that particular application, you can make use of all these functions. Then you have ease decimal, then you are going to get the boolean value true if all the characters in the strings are decimals, right? So ease digit, you can check whether the string contains only digits, right? All these things you can make use of. Beautiful inbuilt methods you have. Just make sure that you make a note of it. I'm going to circulate the PDF, of course. So, yeah. Some of them might be deprecated. Some of them you might never use, but make sure you know that they exist. You'll never know when what will be used, right? So, yeah. Moving ahead, all these things are there. Okay. So, that has a formal ending of the theoretical stuff which we went through, all right? Now, let's go ahead and see some things which I plan to tell you people. Now, we have Git. Most of the people, I'm sure all of you have read the poster or the message which I initially circulated for you people to requesting you to join the program. In that, I also mentioned that I'm not going to hand over the certificates because I'm not authorized to do so. I'm not recognized by anybody. I'm not affiliated to any certification authority. Instead, I told that I'll help you set up the GitHub repositories. See, what is GitHub basically? GitHub, let's see how to do that. GitHub is basically a company or a platform, which I would say, recently acquired by Microsoft, initially started by Linus Torvalds, right? He is the developer of Linux, Linux operating system, and he was one of the founding fathers of the Unix operating system, which was built in Bell Labs, AT&T Bell Labs, right? So he played a major role in bringing up Linux kernel, and based on Linux kernel, most of the operating systems running in the corporate and servers being running are on Linux. Linux is a wonderful system which supports, beautifully supports your files, it supports your multi-threading operations and all the operating system features what you actually expect an operating system to have is present in your Linux, and it was implemented a long, long time ago, right? In 20th century, and still it holds good, right? He is the single authority of the Linux distribution, and he has a small office in his home. So he actually developed this GitHub in order to trace his versions. Why do you have to trace your versions? Versions is something, let me give you a crude example. You have your mobile applications installed in your mobile, right? So you'll get the updations, right? Updations through your Play Store every now and then, which adds the features for your application. So at the developer's end, the updations in the development is handled by GitHub, just like the analogous to the updations handled by your Play Store. If somebody, you have a team, you are developing an application, if somebody has implemented an extra feature, they are going to update that particular source code in the GitHub. So another person does add another feature, and he is going to update that particular feature in the GitHub. So it is a central repository which contains the common files to a particular team, and they are going to continuously update their particular files and features so that everybody is in sync. Right? That's a beautiful concept. So you can also trace the versions. So at this particular time, this particular developer has committed this particular change in the existing code. So just in case if your code goes rogue, just in case your code goes bananas, if after adding an extra feature, you can always revert back or get the previous version of your code. Okay, that's exactly why GitHub is used. GitHub can also be used to display your work in a specific field in programming. You can always upload your code to GitHub for people to contribute. It is one of the biggest contributors for the vision of open source softwares. So whatever you upload in GitHub, unless you have an account, business account, it will be open source. Anybody can view it, right? Anybody can search for it using the tags, and anybody can view it. Anybody can clone it. Or the other word, clone is nothing but the other word of downloading. Anybody can download or clone it and make modification, and they can submit for reviews, right? So just in case if your software is proprietary, if you want your software to be secret, you'll keep it to yourself, or you can buy a subscription at GitHub at $4 per month per user in a team, then you can make use of it, right? So this is a very brief introduction of GitHub. So let's see how GitHub is going to benefit us. So you are working on Python program since last 7 days. So what you can do is you can take all the files, right? Upload it to your GitHub repository. Create a repository and then upload it. Repository you can create by the name of Python programming, Python bootcamp, Python tutorials, Python practice. Okay, whichever name you would prefer, right? So moving ahead, let's see how it can be done. I request all of you to open your Google, then just type GitHub. Once you have done that, as you can see, once you have done that, go to your first link. Just to make sure, the URL is github.com. Okay, when you click it, it will ask you to sign up. For me, it is not going to ask me to sign up, as I have already have a repository in GitHub. See, here I have already a repository called Playground, Beta Destructor Playground. My coding name is Beta Destructor, right? Wherever you see Beta Destructor, that's me, right? So Beta Destructor, for B small lowercase and D uppercase, followed by Playground. I have done it in 2019 August. So that it helps my placement activities. So I coded a couple of programs and just uploaded it. Yeah, area of square, all these things, right? These are just files which I coded and just uploaded it, right? So you can make the same. Yeah, bubble sort, main Java. See, these are all the files which I've worked on. Right, so you can make use of it. You upload all your code, type all your code and upload it on your repository, create a repository and upload it, and take the link of this particular repository, right? How do you do that? Go to Playground, this is your repository, and clone or download. You can copy this particular link, https. Anybody with this link can get access to this particular repository. All right, copy this link and paste it in your resume, so that, or convert it into a QR code and paste it in your resume, so that your recruiters can readily scan it using Google Lens, and they can look it up in their mobile itself. Right, these are some smart tips to impress your recruiter. Right, small things. So what I did was I had a 4-page resume. It was huge. Everybody used to scold me, why don't you reduce it? So I say, I'll miss out the things if I reduce it. I have to mention all these things. I have worked hard for last three and a half years. I need to mention this. So how I went about it is, I created another resume with very, very short description of each of them. And I created a QR code at the left bottom of that particular resume, and below that QR code it read, for detailed resume, for more details please scan this QR code. When somebody scanned that QR code, it would redirect to my drive file where my detailed resume would exist. All right, so that detailed resume would If they are interested, they can go ahead and go through all the details of the detailed resume. As simple as that. So these are some small tips which you can accept, right? So always detailed resume is better, but only when the recruiter is interested. When the recruiter is already fed up by interviewing such humongous amount of people, he might not be interested in your resume, 4-page resume. Okay, he might throw it at your face and he would ask you to get out. That's actually happened in, not exactly. He didn't throw the resume on my face. He was very, very rude in my, let me not name the company. In the interview, I went in, he took the resume, he saw 4 pages, and that pissed him real bad, right? He's taking left and right to me. He's not telling directly, it is passive aggression. He's like, he mentioned this, what is that? Saying in Kannada, like, mantra kintlu ugla jasti. He actually said this, right? He actually said this. Mantra kintlo ugla jasti, which means like whatever you are saying too much, but there is so less. You have not accomplished anything. Something similar, right? So all these things happened, and finally, for my astonishment, I actually got the offer. I don't know how. So just make sure that you keep your resume small, and then link that particular small resume to a bigger resume, a detailed resume which contains everything. Okay, let me show you my resume. All right, this might be outdated resume. It's loading. See, this is my detailed resume actually. Here I have QR code which can be scanned to get this particular resume as well. Right? So yeah, this is my resume, old resume, unupdated one. Right, here I have my academic projects. Here I have title of the project, then I have the objective of the project, then I have team size, role, technologies used, tools used, link, then I have leave management system, and so on and so forth. Technologies used, role, all these things, detailed resume, everything I have explained. Voice controlled autonomous vehicle, objective is to design and develop a voice controlled autonomous vehicle which can be controlled using a mobile app. Team size 10, role project lead, technologies used, blah, 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 tools used, blah, blah, blah. So many things, right? You have detailed resume, then you have awards and achievements. These many awards and achievements, then you have extracurricular activities. Yeah, make sure that you put only achievements, not participation. Nobody cares about participation. I want you to achieve and then put it, right? Separate it with respect to your curricular and extracurricular. Curricular, which is related to your domain, like computing, or it might be mechanical or something like that, right? Your extracurriculars would be something related to your soft skills, like speaking, like winner of speak up contest or debate competition, right? Examples of awards and achievements will be your techathon or technical treasure hunt or IT quiz or your paper presentation or your whatever it is, right? Here your personal profile, this will be your personal profile, and hobbies will be your sensitive part. Make sure you put hobbies such a way that it looks like beneficial to the company. Don't put your hobbies like watching TV. Be specific, right? What are you watching in TV, right? Like watching English TV series like Friends. Inherently, I'm telling the employer that I'm familiar with Western culture. I'm updated with the pop culture. I have good English, right? I'm just letting this guy know, my recruiter know. I'm updated. I can understand a foreign language. Sherlock Holmes, I don't think so many of you know. It is a British TV series. It has got vibrant English. It has got like the protagonist and the antagonist, they are like rap gods, right? They just spit English. You might hardly understand. I used to take subtitles. Without subtitles, you might not understand. So that level of English. So I'm just telling the recruiter inherently, subconsciously, that I'm good at all these things. Right, I have watched the TV series which are beneficial for me. I'm good at communication, so on and so forth. Right, this marks the end of your resume. This is your detailed resume. If you want the shorter version, this will be your shorter version, single page resume. Okay, this might not be updated. Fine. Here you'll have work experience. You have worked. I had worked as an intern in a company. Then my training, my interests. Right, my interest was in cybersecurity. I've put it. My interest is in multimedia computer networking. I've put it. Then the projects undertaken. Then I've got achievements, right? So on and so forth. Education, skills. So it's one glance, no explanation. So something like that. Vinay, your spelling is wrong. It's not Holmes. It is Holmes. Remember the spelling. Okay. Abhishek says perfect. Hobbies that also show that you have a personal life. You have a public life, right? You're not an introvert. You love to get combined with people, so on and so forth, right? So next up the list. Hope that was beneficial. Next, how to read a question and form a logic. This is for the people who are interested in programming, competitive programming, right? This is for the people who are interested in getting recruited in companies who act co who act who ask coding, right? They might give you a problem statement and give you 30 minutes and ask you to solve all those problems. It might be couple 2 to 3, right? So first of all, first tip being, read the question patiently, right? I understand there might be some examples where they have given some redundant and unnecessary data, like they have given stories like Elf, Toby, Harry Potter, the Sherlock Holmes, all those nonsense they would have given. But I request you to patiently read Avengers, right? Avengers. All those bullshit, I mean, not bullshit, please don't take offense. I'm a DC fan, I'm a Joker fan, right? So, Avengers, they have put it, and I request all of you people to patiently read the question, right? That is point number one. Then you concentrate on the constraints given, right? Some of the times the constraints of the input will be up to 10 raised to 6 or 10 raised to 9. The inputs might be given up to 10 raised to 9. So make sure that the programming language which you are using is able to is able to manage that amount of input. And also make sure that the data type and the specifiers which you are using can also accommodate that length of inputs. Like you might use long int or unsigned long int, right? These all things helps. So that is second thing what I would say. The third thing is identify a repetition in the logic, right? There will be one thing or the other thing which has to be done repeatedly over number of times, right? Understand this, people. There will be a particular task in the solution of the program given which has to be done repeatedly, right? Identify that particular repeatedly done task, right? Once you identify the task, know the starting point and the ending point of that repetition. Know when to start that repetition, know when to end that repetition. Right? Then know what is the input of that repetition, input to the repetition. If it is directly the input given by the user, or it is the conversion of the input given by the user to some standard and then using it. Right? Then once you figure this thing out, analyze the repetition. Break it down, divide it completely, part by part. It's called designing and analysis of algorithms. Part by part, I request you to go through that particular repetitive task, what you need to do, right? Once you identify the parts, divide it until and unless it is so simple that each and every element of that part can be implemented with the least possible IQ which you have. Right, if you have say 110 IQ, it should be able to solve it using your 90 IQ itself, right? Until and unless you get that level of simplicity, you just go on dividing. This is very helpful in initial days. So once you start doing this, you might reach a place where you might not have to divide it entirely, right? You can just approach the program itself, right? The division is very, very essential for you to understand the chits and bits of the program, right? Once you divide it, start conquering it, right? Once you conquer it, automatically everything falls into place and you have a solution. Then before submitting the solution, make sure you run with your custom inputs. There might be programs whose output cannot be determined by you. It has to be automated because the process can be very, very cumbersome. You might have matrix operations involved. You might have mathematical operations involved. In that case, I request you to go ahead with the test case provided itself. Right, as far as possible, you can try with the custom inputs as well. And the last suggestion being, be very, very careful at edge cases. Recently, I took part, I got invited in Google Foobar Challenge, right? For the people who know Foobar Challenge. Foobar Challenge is it is for the people who Google the question, programming question a lot. So Google algorithms analyze if you're Googling too many program related questions, and at one point it is going to invite you people to participate in its test, in its secret test. There will be 5 levels, and if you efficiently pass through all the 5 levels or pass the 3rd level, you have an option to request the Google recruiter to have a look at your code, right? And he's going to analyze the code, and he's going to if he's satisfied, he might ask you to finish the next 2 levels of challenge, and you might get hired, who knows, right? And the good news is you can use only 2 languages in Google Foobar. Either it is Python or it is Java. So kaboom, you almost have Python in your hands, right? So in this case, they'll have 10 hidden cases. 10 hidden cases, I repeat. Then my code was rejected because one of the test cases in level 3 was rejected. It failed, right? That was a 96-hour challenge. The question was given, and I was given 96 hours to solve that particular question. And only one test case didn't pass. 9 test cases passed, and one test case didn't pass. And my code was rejected. And luckily, after this was at 66th hour, and approaching to 80th hour, somehow the edge case, I could detect a normal flaw in the solution, and I was able to fix it. Right? So, yeah. Then later, this thing happened. The session happened. I was unable to get back there. So these are things. These are my experiences which I would love to share. So make sure your edge cases are perfect. Edge cases in the sense the last cases, like the limits. Like if your limit is given as 10 raised to 9, make sure that the 10 raised to 9th element also is also executable in your program. That's the key, right? So yeah, that is. These are some tips which I could give. Now the last topic, how to take it from here. Now that you know the basic concepts of Python programming is almost pretty much it, except for object orientation, right? Object orientation is out of the scope of this particular course. If you master the object orientation, the basic standard library of your Python is pretty much it. This is maximum what we are going to use. Then you can explore your additional packages like Flask. You can explore NumPy. You can explore sklearn. You can explore so many other things, right? So these are your modules which are having the functions, methods required to execute your domain specific applications. Like it might be your machine learning, it might be your IoT, it might be your deep learning, it might be your data analytics, right? So find out your passion. Is it your data analytics? Are you good at mathematics? Go for data analytics. If you are good at statistics, go for data analytics. If you are good at machine learning, if you are good at mathematics, right? If you are good at algorithms, go for machine learning, right? Deep learning, artificial intelligence. If you are good at hardware, right? If you are good at IoT and stuff, go ahead with your hardware programming, maybe MicroPython, or maybe your Raspberry Pi programming, right? So this is pretty much it. This is your language, Python language. You are capable of understanding the code. You're at that stage where you are capable of understanding the code, what actually it is, and tracing out the code. So please be in touch. Python is like a wonderful friend. If you are saying hi to it considerably frequently, it is going to be a friend with you. If not, it is going to be your enemy. It will be like, in Kannada, we say, Kabinat Kadlakai, right? It's like your metal groundnuts. You can't achieve it. So, yeah, this is pretty much it. Find out your passion, work on it, right? So I really appreciate all of you people for taking up this course, right? Because frankly speaking, nowadays I have seen my peers, I have seen my friends, I have seen my batchmates, I have seen my college mates, I have seen my peers from other colleges without any reward, like a certificate or a prize or something like that. Nobody is going to do anything. But let me tell you people, participation for anything is not going to fetch you anything, right? Just participation is never going to fetch anything. What matters is your work, okay? Better than a certificate, you can update your GitHub repository frequently, right? As you can see, they can see the date. Okay, this was one of the biggest blunder. I did everything at a time and I uploaded everything once itself. Please don't do the mistake which I did. Make sure it is incremental. Make sure that your repository shows consistency, right? You have worked over a period of time, right? Make sure that this happens. That is one more suggestion I could give, right? Abhishek says, questions are easy most of the time. It's the constraints that will make you change your approach to the test for your real. Absolutely right. Correct. Also the representation of the answer. That's also true. Oh, thanks Prasanna, thanks for reminding me this. Make sure that you print exactly what is asked for, not a single space extra, not a single character extra, right? Make sure this happens. What is asked for, that should only be given to you, given by you, right? So how are the questions like? I'll tell you. Please contact me. I'll let you know. You can Google it out. There are so many online platforms which from where we got it. Fubar, terrible. I weeped for hours together. You would not understand how. You would not understand the question itself. To understand questions, I have taken more than like 3 to 4 hours. I have requested all my contacts. Oh my God, terrible questions. You should know. I got this question called Markov chain, right? I have never even heard of what Markov chain is, right? So, yeah, you should be really, really powerful. And very, very few people who are going to attend the Fubar challenge and again, there are other challenges given by your Google, namely, what is it? Kickstart is the one which you would want to participate in. I participated in round C, right? So these are the places which you can get in. If not, you are if you cannot penetrate through the process, you'll definitely learn a thing or two, right? You'll never have a loss, right? So make sure you work on it. And just for your information, Google or your Walmart or your Flipkart or your Tesla, any of these companies, they don't ask your degree, they don't ask what your marks are, they don't ask your who the hell you are. They just care about your knowledge, talent, and soft skills, communication skills. Right? Please work on your communication skills, learn how to talk, learn how to be presentable. I understand you will be very polite inside your head, but that's not enough. You should also be polite outside. The other person should also feel as if you are polite, right? Scold whatever you want inside your head, just be polite in front, right? That's all matters. And learn your formal skills, learn how to approach to a person. All these things matters. All these things matters a lot, right? So anything else you want me to explain or anything else you want from me, please feel free to text it. I can we have 5 more minutes, I guess, right? The last day. If just in case if anybody has not transferred money yet, I've got around 40 people. How about Code Chef? Yes, Dhanendra, you can practice Code Chef challenges. Definitely. Wherever you say competitive programming, just head out there. Just, if you have time, just go ahead, solve the problems. Right? Chai kaha hai, milega, milega Vinayak bhai. How to learn more Python from this level forward? You can, wonderful question, Yogesh. You can go ahead with documentation. Go to Google, type Python documentation. Right? This is the best place and the most reliable place to learn Python. Right? They have ready-made notes just like book. Right? So what's new in Python 3.8? Tutorial. Sorry, should have clicked tutorial. Here you have. These are all your tutorials. So here is where you learn advanced programming, advanced concepts. All right. So Python tutorial, it starts from scratch, right? Range, if statements, for statements. This is actually where I got my interest in Python. The documentation, this is written by the developers themselves, right? So you have these many things to cover up, right? I just got you started. So go ahead, learn all these things. Right, lambda functions, you have unpacking argument list. These are all advanced topics which I couldn't cover, unfortunately. But please go ahead and serve yourself, right? So anything else? Udemy, you need to pay money, right? Udemy, I have object oriented notes which I have learned when I learned object oriented programming in Udemy is great. It depends on your this one the course which you are taking. Just make sure that there are ample amount of students enrolled, right? Then check the ratings, check the comments, check the reviews, right? If the user has more than if the course has more than 10,000 or 20,000, and if the course has like 4.5 above rating, it is considered to be a good course, right? If the course has 50,000 subscribers, it is a wonderful course, right? Ratings and the number of the three parameters: ratings, the number of students enrolled, then the reviews, right? You can also take a demo class, right? And however, you can always tap into free courses. What they do actually is they are going to give out the courses for free for some limited amount of subscribers just to get the ratings, just to get the course started. So there are some Telegram channels where you can get the links every now and then. You can search for those channels and subscribe to those channels and keep yourself updated there. They'll give you the links, then you can go there and just enroll before it goes out of hand. Right, so Udemy is good, best of the best sources, DS-Algo, the basic part of software engineering, best of the best resource for DS algorithm, data structures. I have seen Rima Tareja's book is wonderful, right? Go for Rima Tareja's book, and for algorithms, I request you to go to Levitin. Levitin is perfect. Levitin for algorithms and Rima Tareja for DS. Perfect. This one, perfect selection, right? So I don't think so. I'm going to make one more course. I'm really tired. This is very, very cumbersome process, right? So just in case, if there is inevitable situation, I'm going to contact your people. If there is anything, if anybody needs favor from me, any charity, or I need a favor for myself, who knows? So I'm going to contact your people. Please do subscribe back if you really think it is going to. If you really believe that I'm going to make your time worthwhile, right? Please consider coming back and subscribing, right? I'll make sure that it is affordable, right? Okay, rate the class, rate today's class, people. Rate today's class. Come on, everybody. I want all the 40 people to rate. Arshad says 8. Okay. Arshad, please text me. Why do you think it is 8? Then, okay. Everybody says 10, 10, 10, 10, 10. Aditya says 100 on 100. Nice. Beautiful. Beautiful. I want you people to stick around. Please don't leave the meeting. Please don't leave the meeting. Sushma says 10. No changes. Come on. You people are. Abhishek, what is VFM? Because I was unable to understand few programs. Please feel free to bounce back. I'm going to explain. If you feel it, you are not understanding anything, please feel free to bounce back. Value for money. All right. Okay. इतना मार्क्स तो तुझे वीडियो भी नहीं देगा. ओह माय गॉड, टेल मी मोर. आई एम एन एवरेज स्टूडेंट मैन. आई हैव नेवर बीन टॉपर इन माय क्लास, नेवर इन माय एंटायर लाइफ. ओके, विनायक सेज 9. आई नीड द स्टार्ट नीड टू स्टार्ट फ्रॉम बेसिक्स. श्योर, आई विल हेल्प यू विद इट. दीपा सेज ऑल ऑफ योर क्लासेस आर गुड. थैंक यू दीपा, थैंक्स, मीन्स अ लॉट. आई विश आई गॉट द मार्क्स व्हिच यू हैड गिवन from my video, right? Never got an out of out, man. Not in my entire life.